Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be starting in 3 minutes.
Hello. Good evening. Thanks for coming. This is an event organized by Data Science Brussels, which is a fragment of the data science community, which is you have meetups all around Belgium, mostly to the Flemish part, but whatever. Data Science Brussels began like 5 years ago. And it has a long history, which I will not bore you with. But bottom line, we started again this year to organize meetups. And we always try to have a mix of business a technical subject and audience, you. The point is really to try to make links between people which know the subject of the study and people who know how to make such a study. I really think that legal tech, which is the subject tonight, which is not the subject of every meetup, but which is the subject tonight, is an extremely exciting subject because it's something that can grow a lot because right now it is way smaller than the opportunities which arise from it. We always organize those meetups here at the Digitizer with Philippe, which is our godfather because he started the community. And then he evolved into doing so many things and doesn't have the time to organize it anymore, so we have to do it. So thank you very much for hosting us. So I will just give the mic to him so that he can explain a bit the place.
Hello, everybody. Good evening. Very, very warm welcome to you all. Thomas said, we created the data science community 2014 already. The first meetup was held on the 26th of March. We were 26 people in the room. Sébastien was there, Limpool and others. I think Wart was there also. Wart, where are you? Wart was there when we started as well. And since then, we've done about 120 different events and meetups and trainings in different places. When we started with the data science community, we decided to focus on business topics, but we wanted to show the technological side of what was happening on that business topic. And that had quite a success. We very rapidly grew. We were doing our events either at the ULB or at the VUB. At one point, we had the meetup where there were 250 people present in the aula. And that's where we said, aula, we have to do something about it. This becomes something important. And we decided then to organize the first full day event, which was the Data Innovation Summit. And AXA invited us to use their bigger room. So we went there on 1 year later, 26th of March 2015. And very soon afterwards, AXA gave us a space of 600 square meters where we could regularly meet, do some workshops, hold a hackathon. And in that space, there were also 12 training rooms. And we said, that's a pity not to use them. So we put those 12 training rooms and we made them available for anyone who wants to share their knowledge. And so that's why we started to do some trainings on Python. We did some training on TensorFlow and all the different elements that you can imagine that a data scientist wants to do. After a while, AXA moved from Boisfort to the center of Brussels. And we had to look for another space. We looked along for quite a long time to find a space. We found a lot of spaces that were like office spaces, like a shoebox into a building. And then we were lucky enough to be invited to come and visit this space, which at that time was empty. And when we saw this, we believed that that was the place where we wanted to work for the next 10 years. It's a space with a big ground floor where we can hold up to 150 people. If the meetups are smaller, we just project on the side wall, and then it's a nice, comfy meetup of 30 people. And then we can also allow people to start creating their own startup, and that happens in the different floors here. Because all these parts of offices are open, it's quite easy for one startup to see when his colleague in the other startup is available if he has a question. And we feel that there is a lot of co-creation happening here just because of this open environment. On the top floor, there is a huge terrace that we also use, and we use that mostly to rent it out for corporates so that they can partly finance the building here. The corporates really like it because they can be up to 80 people in one room. Next to that room, there is a big dining room, and next to that room there's the 200 square meter rooftop terrace where they can walk on as well, and that's where the main money comes from. It's from the rentals we do for corporates. That's basically our story. This is a 10-year project. We are supported by Region of Brussels, who wanted that all the tech communities could have their own space, their own clubhouse. We call it the clubhouse of the tech communities of Brussels, to meet and to share knowledge. We are very lucky to have the owner of the building believing in this project. It's Sofina, which is the owner of the building. And we also have a big support by the companies on the other side of the street, which is ENGIE, Proximus, Euroclear, all the big corporates, who want to be as close as possible to people like you. Because you know they know that this is where things are happening, and this is where the startups are happening. So that's what I wanted to say. Know that this is your room, this is your space, this is your clubhouse when you want to organize a meeting, a short meeting with a few people in a room like that with 10 people, or even bigger meetings up to 60 on the rooftop, or 200 if there is a need to here in the atrium. So without further ado, I would hand on the mic.
Philippe. So just to say, okay, we have three speakers tonight, 20 minutes each, then a few questions, so it's okay, and then afterward we will have a drink down there if you want to join us. So please welcome our first speaker, who is Aurélien over there, the head of data science of ReactFin. So it's not per se a legal tech company, but he will talk about legal tech and insurance, and ReactFin is a top-notch company on insurance. So yeah, welcome, yeah. Aurélien.
Thank you. Le bip. C'est pas grave. C'est pas grave, on fera sans.
Super.
Merci beaucoup. Okay, hi everyone. Thanks for the invitation. So yeah, as explained, it's a bit funny that I'm starting because I'm not properly speaking legal tech. React Fin is a consulting firm in actual science, basically. But yes, so why am I here tonight, except for the great beer? Actually, 2 years ago, when we started the data science initiative at React Fin, we started to look into the different opportunities we have in insurance and the financial sector. And we quickly noticed that one of the main topics will be to understand words more than numerical aspects. And so, yeah, we started to think about that, to think a lot about that. And quickly we realized that it was indeed a huge, huge, huge topic because a lot of unstructured data are available in these industries, and because they are continuing to produce such an amazing amount of unstructured data. And so we started to list all these unstructured data. We noticed that, of course, they were producing a lot of contracts, a lot of invoices, but also some claims reports. And quickly, we also noticed that they have, of course, some regulatory rules, that they have some technical notes related to these regulatory rules. Well, a lot of things that, well, told us that maybe it was quite interesting maybe to work on this material instead of simply working on numerical value. And so we think we thought a lot about what will be the great business case to start to propose some first initiative related to text and unstructured data. And well, we found a lot of topic. And one of the first and most relevant topic actually we noticed was the analysis of reinsurance treaties. So for those who are not in this sector, basically it's the automation of very large contract review. So basically all the legal team could be used data science technology to automate a part of their job regarding these contracts. Okay, so just to give you a quick overview about this business case, what is a reinsurer? A reinsurer is basically an insurer of an insurer. So when I'm talking about contracts, basically I'm not talking about small contracts. I'm talking about really huge contract with millions of premiums. When I'm talking about reinsurance treaties, I'm also talking about thousands of documents published each year, because each year the contracts are renegotiated between different parties. Okay, and these contracts, I gave you some example over there. The contract contains all the information related to the coverage, so basically the specificities related to the area, the amount covered, and so on. The other thing related to this business case is that it required a lot of highly qualified persons, so basically actuaries, underwriters, legal inspect, and all these guys have to work on this material each year. So there are some cost topic, of course, about this business case. And the last thing is, of course, related to this thousand of hours of work, because they have to first to write the contract, then to review this contract, then to assess that all the mandatory elements inside this contract are available, then to check with their compliance rules that all the paragraph, all the clauses that should be put in this document are well put in this document, and many others of things. So it's a very consuming job. Regarding a more simple aspects, if you imagine a reinsurance treaty, you can imagine a document of maybe 40 to 50 pages, very, very technical, and mainly of many formats. It's not one common predefined format, because depending on the reinsurer you are working with, depending on the broker you are working with, well, each of them have their own templates. So it's not an easy and structured business case, let's say. So we work on this topic and we think about how could we simplify the life of all these people. So the first goal, and I really present you the first goal, was basically just to create a simple and scalable tool that can, well, first collect information, so just to pick up information in order to just assess if all the mandatory criteria are available in the document. Then to understand the architecture of this document, well, mainly to recognize that, well, there are all the paragraphs that are required. And also, third thing, try to understand some of the topics inside this architecture, with the idea also to compare well, the main topic inside this paragraph with, well, standard topic, at least topics that are okay with the compliance of the team, of the legal team, sorry. And the last thing, of course, well, basically just save time, because it was completely fastidious, too consuming, and it required too much time and, well, not interesting time, to be honest. So the idea was really to save time in order to let expert people do their job, so basically manage, well, the complex cases, okay? So how did we work on this subject from an IT framework, maybe first? Well, quite something quite basic. So we use Python for all the statistical learning aspect. We use TensorFlow for the NLP and text mining aspect. We use Spacy, and we use some other libraries. Depending on the subject, we also use Tesseract as OCR to manage the documents. And for many other aspects, such as front-end or whatever, we use, let's say, the common packages you used to work on. Okay, that's not the most interesting. The most interesting is how did we succeed to do this job. So first, from a user perspective, well, the first idea was just to assess the type of the document. So among a lot of documents, just try to classify what are the documents that are, well, reinsurance treaties. Then to assess the structure of these documents, so basically split the document into several parts, basically clauses, paragraphs. Then assess the topics of this paragraph. Then inside these topics and inside this paragraph, well, basically collect candidates of information that could be, that could interest the legal team or the actuarial team. Then assess this candidate to really qualify the really valuable information we should show to the legal teams. And, well, then return the information from a structured paragraph perspective, but also from a basic, let's say, structured data set. Okay, with the idea also to, let's say, put some user experience so that the legal team in front of the tool could, let's say, modify the results, but also improve the model we use. Okay. Maybe the most interesting from the machine perspective, how did we work? So first, for the classification of the document, depending on the cases we applied the tool or the technology, well, we used to take sometimes just pure static rule, so basic one. Sometimes we use, well, classification supervised machine learning model just to make the distinction between, let's say, short reinsurance treaties that are called slips, or large reinsurance treaties, because after the strategy was not exactly the same. Then when you want to understand the structure of the document, we actually, well, transform the text in, well, vector matrix using word embeddings. So if you want to have further element about this word embeddings, I've not just one answer to give you. We test several word embeddings. First, we try with Word2Vec, because we use it for an English dataset, and it works very well. And then we also use another word embedding called Glove for a French situation. So depending on the situation we work, we don't use the same word embeddings. And then the idea was to use this new representation of the document to predict in the document what were title and what was not a title. So basically to understand in the first step the architecture of the document by assessing this is a title, okay, I split it, this is not a title, I continue, and so on and so on and so on. So that we were able to find a structure to the documents, and then all the idea was to assess the topic of each part of the document. Here again, there are plenty of techniques to do that. We use actually a very simple one because we didn't want to have some classification of multi-labeling classification issue. So we just basically create a distance measure with common topics we have already defined. Because another perspective is that reinsurance treaties are almost all the same. They contain partially a lot of common terms, a lot of common topics. Then when we understand globally the structure of the document, well, basically we have to pick up the info. So we define plenty of customized regex to collect technical information that legal team used to check. And then we also define another model, so another recurrent neural network, assessing the context of this regex to really understand if the information obtained thanks to the regex was relevant first and was mandatory for the legal team. And so we screen it if it's necessary, okay? And then we use some front-end tricks for the user experience aspects. About the results, so this is a basic screenshot of the technology we have implemented now in some reinsurance company. Several now, yeah. For the RNN model, so the first one that used to predict the structure, we have really great results. So basically, we are lower than 2% of error just to assessing. So is it a title or is it not a title? For the topic recognition, it was a bit tricky to define an error measure because the distance measure is not the best thing to do that. But we manually observed that on average, 86% of the topics we have in the scope are well understood by the machine, and for the 14% that remained, the idea was actually just to show this paragraph to the legal team so that they were able to assess, oh, that should be something you should take into this topic, or on the contrary, that's something specific and that's great that you show this, okay? So related to this, we also try to work on the clauses differences, so the differences between paragraph, because another issue for this legal team was not specially just to understand that, okay, this clause is available, that's great, but more than this clause is available, but it's something like an amended clause. So basically, if we are talking about GDPR topics, in the reinsurance treaties, you have a clause dedicated to GDPR right now. The thing is, there is common clause on the market related to this GDPR, but there are also extra rows related to this. So all the idea was first to assess that there is or there not there is not a difference between a common and an amended clause, and then also trying to measure the differences. I will talk a bit later about that. And regarding the criteria, so the understanding of the mandatory criteria inside documents, we were pretty good because we now are able to recognize 92% of the whole mandatory list from this legal team. So I'm talking about mandatory criteria, I'm talking about basically the name of the company which is reinsured, I'm talking about the amount of premiums, I'm talking about the area, the exclusion, the presence of some clauses, and so on. Okay. And for the running time, well, we were just applying some predictions, so we assess all this aspect in less than 10 seconds right now. So the conclusion about this topic, I don't know if I have some times. Yeah. So the conclusion about this topic, it was a very first introduction, you know, in the insurance and the reinsurance sector, the use of NLP techniques and more globally of machine learning techniques, it's quite new. So the first idea was really to create a simple tool to show them that it's feasible to support the legal team on this aspect. And so we try through this tool to improve the life, let's say, of legal team, because, well, we completely erased the time they used to take to just verify information or verify the presence or non-presence of clauses. So that was great. And we also try to go a step further with this understanding of the difference between standard or amended clauses. Of course, in this version, so the one I presented, there are also a lot of limits that is interesting to talk about. Depending on the company you are working with, they have plenty of data quality topics. Okay, so in some situation, the reinsurance treaties are really, really good. So it's basically digital documents, so everything is perfect. But on the contrary, on other situation, I'm more talking about, let's say, kind of image document, transversal image document with part of erased words, and so on. So that generates a lot of noise, of course, in the understanding of the model, but also in the regex, even if we have some levers to control that. The other thing was that we also exclude some very specific cases, because there are some very specific contracts in this market that are definitely not the same as, let's say, common reinsurance treaties. From now, we also use different models to define our strategy, so to define the pipeline. And also regarding the world embedding, there is one critical topic on all these aspects that we are using, as I explained earlier, technical words, and for many reasons, these technical words are not available in the matrix we set up in the world embedding models. So one of the ideas, of course, is to develop its own model on this subject. The last thing regarding the limit is probably that, so for the legal team, we started to define some difference measure, error measure, but based on the simple linguistic aspects, so really the differences in terms of maybe number of different words or stuff like that. The thing is that in such a subject, the idea is not about a basic difference. The difference measure, the error measure, is more a risky measure. So there is a huge R&D topic at the moment in the company on how should we give some weights to predefined words or stuff like that, just to assess the risk more than the basic difference. And the last thing is that, as explained, insurance is not a specialist of machine learning and NLP techniques. It's something that's just popped up maybe 2 or 3 years ago. But we really noticed that even if some people were, let's say, against such project, with a very basic application, a basic tool where you're able to show very basic things, and that you also ask to the user to give feedback, to assess the quality, but in a friendly way, well, it's really helped the user also to accept the changes, because they will have to accept these changes. So I give as a final quote, let's say, something that someone told me in one of the company we work with: the tool transform the difficulties of change management in opportunities and self-fulfillment. Now that's something very true. Actually, it really allows this legal team to focus on the complex situation and to actually really do the job they like. I think that's all. I don't know if you have a question. Feel free to ask it right now, or maybe later on technical topic. Just one last thing: if you are also very interested on this topic, we are hiring at ReactFin, so feel free to contact me. Thank you.
Questions?
Yes.
The first, so the error measure regarding the RNN was something we, so we define a training set manually, and so it was an average per document. Okay, so basically, on average, if you study documents, you will have something like, 30 to 40 titles. We are able to recognize 38 of them, something like that. Yeah.
We have the time for another question. Yeah.
And explain a bit more how you incorporate the business users in your application.
The business feedback, you mean?
No, no, how did you incorporate the users, like using the tool? How did you manage that?
Oh, did they use the tool, I mean, on a regular basis right now? So the question is how the user are using the tool today in the company. Yeah, the idea is actually each year there is something between September and December called le renouvellement, the renew basically. And on this period, they receive a lot of material and they also produce a lot of material. And the tool from now, because it's, well, that's something like 1 year ago, it's just a kind of additional tool and kind of add-in, and they just put the document inside the app and they just receive, let's say, the translation in structured data and also in architecture terms and recommendation and so on. And so at the moment, there is no, let's say, direct link with the data flow, so we have not specified any database behind this, so that we are able also to compare from 1 year to another. But it's just a static speech, a static picture of the assessment, of the legal assessment. So yeah.
Okay. Thanks again, Aurélien. Yeah. If you want to keep discussing, you can do that after. We have to. Thank you very much. You can thank him also. So now we have Dodo from not from Jetpack, which is married to somebody from Jetpack, which is a very cool AI company which can basically do anything. Well, the people working for the company can do anything. And actually, there was a legal use case they wanted to tackle at a legal hackathon, and they won. So we invite them to talk about it. Thank you for coming. So please welcome Dodo.
Okay, excellent. So hello everyone. So I'm Gauthier Krings from Jetpack. I don't know if you've introduced me actually, but okay. So I'm here with Dea to talk to you about Magpie indeed. But before that, I would like to explain you indeed how we got here, because something quite odd happened to us. So 10 days ago, Karim received the email of invitation, like you all did, to attend to the meetup. And so out of curiosity, he checked what was the lineup for the evening, and he said, oh, well, Jetpack is presenting how we actually won the hackathon. It was quite a surprise for us because we never got informed about this. So we did a bit of a research of how this all happened, and we suspect that Philippe got a bit wild on. Okay. Okay. No. Maybe you imagine that. Of course. Yeah. We would. Okay. No, it's not a fault. I mean, it was just funny for us to notice so that we were speaking. And so we discovered at the same time as well the title of our presentation, which was how did Jetpack win the hackathon? And we were lucky that you didn't go too wild on the title. Like not saying, well, Jetpack invented with fancy AI or data science how to disrupt the legal tech scene, because we did nothing of that. So it was, yeah, we're happy to share our story today. But so just a small disclaimer for the rest of the talk, if you are here for data science and for smart algorithms, well, we have nothing, nada. Zit. rien de rien. So it's going to be about the hackathon. because in retrospect, when we thought a bit about what we've been doing during this hackathon with the team, for us it was we performed a very efficient product design sprint. So thinking about what was the concrete problem that the lawyers have been explaining to us, and how could we structure a coherent solution that was showable in 24 hours and giving them the idea of what would be like the larger problem we could address with our solution. And that ended up in Magpie, which was quite a success for us at least. It was good for us to get through this. So to give you a bit of context on what it was, so in Brussels we are quite lucky to have an incubator with one of the founders is sitting here in the first row, an incubator around legal tech, so which is founded by the Brussels Bar, and the goal of the incubator is to bridge these two very distant worlds, which are the lawyers and the geeks, the engineers, and so they organize a hackathon to bring together those two worlds. Around debt recovery. So they had a very precise question about debt recovery, which was that it's a very complex and tiring a process for lawyers. And so they were asking to the teams in 24 hours to come with a solution to simplify this process for them, so help the lawyers. So we had to develop this application in 24 hours, and then we were presenting this to a jury of experts. This jury was then voting for three teams who would then win the one of the three prizes of the jury, and then those three teams were brought in front of the lawyers of the Brussels Bar, who were then also voting to have a final winner on the of the hackathon. So we constituted a small team of seven people. So we had four lawyers and three engineers. Three engineers from Jetpack. This is why we are here. And so we built a solution, which we called Magpie, as a wink to the debt recovery, and also the robe of the lawyers, which looks a bit like the feathers of the Magpie. So we designed this. Thank you. We designed the solution, and pretty efficient. So we won one of the three prizes during the hackathon, and then we won again the final prize by 70% of the votes a couple of weeks ago. For the next the rest of the presentation, so Dea is going to explain you a bit more what debt recovery is, and so how Magpie is trying to address this. And then I will come back at the end for a small demo of what we have developed during the hackathon, and so how we foresee to evolve over the next months.
Okay. So hi everyone. I'm glad to be here tonight. That's the first time I'm attending a data science meetup. I think it's quite unusual for a lawyer to talk in front of an audience with majority of engineers, but I'll try to be to do a simple presentation of what we did and what we wanted to do with the application. So, debt recovery, of course, that's interesting topic, but that's not the most exciting job of a lawyer. Why? Because a lot of tasks are repetitive and time-consuming. So Debt recovery is, you can imagine a lawyer having different big clients, let's say an energy company and a telecom company, and those companies instruct the lawyers having, okay, we have customers who don't pay their bills, we have unpaid invoices, can you go to court or to the bailiff and get recovery of the debt? So you can imagine a lawyer going to court in the morning with 50 or 60 files and then getting a judgment on the same day. So we want something a tool that would address repetitive tasks. So basically in a debt recovery process, what would do a lawyer, he would draft notice, formal letters to send to the debtor, and then if the debtor doesn't react, then he can bring a claim in court or work with a bailiff. So those are a lot of administrative tasks that are not really added value, and also the lawyer can make mistakes because of the lawyers and maths are not always compatible, so it's you have to juggle with figures, so you can make, of course, errors and mistakes. And from a client's perspective, debt recovery, well, the client doesn't always have a visibility on costs and also the payments that the lawyer receives. For example, in the formal letter, the lawyer says, you have to pay me this amount. Well, the client doesn't really know any time when the money is coming on the bank account. And usually, he doesn't also have a full picture of the lawyer's task, and then he would receive a bill, oh, this is all the hours that the lawyer worked, I'm not going to pay this, etc. And so then the lawyer has to recover his own debt against his own client. So that's the visibility on cost, but also on the predictability. How much would it cost me for lawyer's fees, for the bailiff's leave, how much I would get at the end if I engage a procedure, if I engage a claim in court, is it worth going in court or not? So it's difficult for a client to get a clear predictability of costs and also of the results. You have to know that for the results in Belgium, we have more than 1 million judgments per year. But what is public and what is published is actually less than 1%. So if we have a search engine that is publicly available for lawyers, that is called Juridat, but if you go there, we maybe have a couple of, I think we had in 2017 300,000 decisions, but since these are all the decisions since the 16th, but since World War II, we had more than 40 million of judgments. So what we really need is that all the judgments being computerized. But there are some obstacles for that, is that first, not all the tribunals want to publish all their decisions, and also if you want to publish a decision, you have to anonymize, so you have to delete all the personal data that is in the judgment. So the app we want to focus on three main aspects. First is the transparency on cost, so you can control of how much I spend in my lawyer's fees, how much I already get payments from the adverse party, and also to see the progress of the matters. So Gauthier will show you later, but we have a timeline, an overview of what's going on, and the clients can check at any time where his matter is up to. Second focus was we wanted an efficient and reliable tool. Efficient because we want to save time and time for the lawyer, so he can actually spend this valuable time on quality work, but also on something that where he can charge higher fees. And automation of recurring or repetitive tasks. We can show you that later. That is, for example, generating a formal notice of letter, but also a writ of summons. So like procedural documents that are necessary to introduce, for example, a claim in court, that kind of automation, or just an automated notification for a reminder for the lawyer. And obviously, security is important because we will have personal data on the app, so it has to be secured and reliable in that respect as well. And last thing is we wanted to have a tool where you can have interactions between different parties of the judicial world. So we have lawyers, but we also have the counsel of the adverse party, but also the judge and the bailiff. So we wanted a communication of the file that the lawyer decide to share or not. And then this would facilitate eventually the dispute resolution. So if we want to sum up what is Magpie, first it's a management tool for debt recovery, both for B2C and B2B. You have to know that when you engage in a procedure under Belgian law, you have different procedures that would apply for consumers but also to businesses. So we want to implement in that application something that we call a decision tree. So when the lawyer would create a new file entering the data of the client, then the app would suggest saying, okay, this is the procedure that exists, which one would you like to engage? So that's the management tool for debt recovery. Second, as I said, is automation of these tasks that are time consuming and repetitive, and hopefully this could be used as a platform to solve the claims. Why not having in the future a platform where actually everything happens electronically, so the lawyer uploads all the files in one platform, shares with the adverse party, shares with the judge, and then receives an electronic judgment. This is something that doesn't really exist today, but why not having such kind of platform that would help to facilitate dispute resolution?
Okay, so before going to the demo of the prototype, since this is a data science community and at Jetpack we do also a lot of data science and machine learning, you might wonder, okay, why didn't we integrate any fancy components in there? And so just remember that we had 24 hours to design the prototype, and I'm sure that most of you know this drawing from the Lean Startup, but our idea was that we wanted to be able to show to a jury in the end something which was already working and could materialize the concepts we want to bring in our tool, rather than to already show a very complex and advanced solution but that is not working at all. And when we compare to other teams, we realize that other teams who actually tried to go into the more complex design, so teams which are producing predictive models, will end up usually with having like their wheel or just a prototype of a wheel, while we at least had already our skateboard, or like we like to say in my company, if you want to build your rocket, first build a jetpack, and learn to fly it. And even for presenting, the KISS principle is something that lawyers like to always bring also in front. My father is a lawyer, he was part of the team as well with us, and when I was at high school, he always taught me when I was writing dissertation, keep it short, keep it simple. So having something very simple, as you will see in the demo, at least was enough to talk to lawyers and to show them as well how this abstract thing of an application could become concrete for them. I'm just gonna exit the presentation. Yeah. No, this is not the one here. Okay, so this is the prototype we have been designing. So the lawyer was capable of entering into, and this is all a functional prototype, and so it's not just a static static web pages, so there is a service running behind. And so the lawyer can have the list of all the files that were currently listed. Selecting one of them, well, as Dea was explaining, this principle of transparency, of clarity of the case, the lawyer could directly have access to the amounts which are currently due and have been paid yet. This was also something that could be shown to a client, so you could give access to a client to a restricted part of the website of the application to have access to their own information. There is like a simplified timeline that could also give information to the client for whom usually the processes, the legal processes are quite complex to understand where do we stand actually in the current process and what do we expect, how much time do we expect before the finish. And of course, I mean, all these numbers here are automatically computed, so we have a calendar, for example, where we could integrate all the different deadlines, different parts of the process. We had an interest calculator, so this is something which is taking lots of time, especially to lawyers for whom mathematics are not always the simplest task to perform. But so calculating automatically, and so if you just change some parameter to see directly what would be the difference, was something that was really of value for a lawyer, as well as being able to compute automatically what would be the costs and what would be the benefits of the case, just for the customer to understand if we change some parameter, how is this going to impact as well. So if the lawyer is more expensive than expected, if there are more like procedures, fees that are implied, what would, I mean, would this still be beneficial for them or would it be worth or not? So we went down to generate automatically documents. I'm not going to do this here because I switched computers and I don't have a Word license anymore, so I cannot open the Word documents anymore, but we could generate automatic Word documents with like the letters you need to send to customers to ask them to pay. We're also seeing this as a future platform where actually different the different parts of the case, so the two parties, but as well the bailiff, the judge could access the data, and you don't need to send this by post anymore. So it was really the goal to simplify and to create a solution that could simplify a bit the work for lawyers. So to finish then, to conclude, we have since then opened already part of a solution onto the web. So if you go to magpie.be, you can access already the interest calculator that we are freely providing to the community. We know that some lawyers are already using it and find it quite handy. And so, yeah, this is the first step for us. So now the next steps are going to be to see how we can bring this prototype and this hackathon win to a concrete business, and that's going to be for the next months. Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah,
that's the website.
Just to finish on that.
Thank you. So, part of question again, if on tooling for lawyers.
Yeah, it's less data science, also.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So our next and last speakers are this time a real data legal tech company. Whatever, that's a joke. We have the pleasure to have Evrard, who is managing director at .IP and also head of machine learning, and Vicky, who is lead data scientist over there. And they're really doing state-of-the-art stuff for intellectual property law. So please welcome them.
Okay, thank you all. So so my name is Evra van Zuylen, and I will with Vicky give you an overview of how we apply machine learning at Darts IP. Before doing that, I'm obliged to give a quick introduction on Darts IP. It's more a couple of business slides, but very quickly we'll jump into the machine learning part of the company. So, quick introduction on Darts IP. We have been created in 2006. In 2006, we took the idea over from a lawyer in Belgium, in Brussels, who was collecting trademark decisions. So he was collecting trademark decisions from the Brussels courts, from the Paris courts, and so on. And he started to classify this decision manually, saying this topic is addressed, this topic, and so on. And the main goal, of course, was to sell a database to its clients where they could search by legal topics. And we started the company in 2006. And in 2011, we did, in the beginning, mainly European content. We decided to do a graphical, a geographical expansion, and we added about 50 countries up to 2016. So today, we are collecting case law decisions from judges across the world and putting in a database system and putting some algorithms that allow our clients to find relevant decisions for the cases. In 2016, we also started to do partnerships with external companies where we start to sell our data. And of course, for us, the biggest partnership we did is with Google, where Google is buying some of our data to put in their own patent database that they put online. We are today about 200 persons across the world in this company. So the type of clients we have, mainly law firms. So a big part of our clients are law firms having an IP practice. So law firms across the world, but we also have more and more corporations. And of course, we are very happy to have corporations like Apple, Samsung, Google, and so on, using our database because they need to find the relevant data when they have an IP litigation somewhere in the world. They like to know what's the likelihood to win my case. I have a trademark, I have a patent. How is a judge going to react on a topic? Can I see the behavior of a judge? Can I see the behavior of another party? Is it aggressive? I know. Oh no. And so this kind of information about cases is very important for them to set their strategy to go to litigation, yes or no, or to settle, and so on. And of course, the last part of clients we also have are courts. More and more courts are using our database to find their own case law or case law from the other courts to make assessments. So for example, the European Court of Justice is one of our customers as well. So which data? That's something getting more interesting for you. Basically, we collect data everywhere in the world. So what we do, we go physically in courts, in Tokyo, in Seoul, in New York, everywhere. We collect data either manually or electronically. The US, the UK, Netherlands, that's great. You can go online, you can put robots on it. That's not a problem. The problem, of course, is when you go to Italy, you go to Spain, you go to Japan and so on, you really have physically to go there, scan it, put it back in the system and so on. And one of the speakers before spoke about OCR quality. That's typically one of the big problems we're facing. All the AI you do, if your OCR is not good, you're going to create a lot of noise down the road. But basically, that's really how we collect the data. And so as you can see, we collect the data in different formats. Sometimes we go back to the 60s, where we collect the data from old books. We go collect the data sometimes from CDs that the lawyers are giving to us. Or even in some countries, we still see some handwritten decisions. Handwritten decisions are not very nice for AI. It's a bit of a nightmare. Fortunately, it's still an exception, but it still exists. So what do we do with the decision? We have, so decisions are text rendered by the courts, and we try to extract a maximum of the data automatically. So what's in the decision? You have, of course, the name of the court, the date, the parties, which kind of party? Is it a company? Is it a person? Because if it's a person, you have to anonymize it. Is it an university? And so on. Which kind of action? Is it an infringement action? Is it a cancellation request and so on? The patent number. And then very important, what are the topics that have been discussed and what has the judge decided? So for example, to take a case of a patent, has which patent topic has been discussed, for example, inventive step, and what has the judge decided? And all those topics we have to enter in the system to allow very fine-tuned research by your clients. So, to give an example, and this is before our AI, this is the beginning, what we were doing. You see that on the right side, the decision, and on the left side, our analysts were manually extracting the information. So they went into the decision, they did copy-paste of the parties, copy-paste of the dates, and so on. And for example, here they did an analysis, a legal analysis of the document. So they look in the text and they say, okay, the judge has discussed that topic, and they're looking, for example, in what's written in red, and then they put the legal topic on the left side. This was done manually in the beginning, so a lot of work. But we are very, very lucky we did that, because of course this has created for use for us a huge amount of training data. We have been done during years and years classifying documents manually on more than 600 topics. And of course, we get a huge amount of training data now that we can use. So why machine learning? As said, in 2012, we decided to do a geographic expansion. And you can see on the graph what that means for us is that the number of documents just exploded. So in the beginning, when we were still a European company, we had about 300,000, 400,000 decisions. Once we decided to go globally, we are hitting now up to 5 million documents. And it's a cumulative number, but it's an important number, because when you do AI, or you do machine learning or whatever, very often some business guy come back and say, well, I would like to do this extra function in our system. You have to reprocess all the backlog. So you have to go back in the 5 million documents. So those 5 million documents are really actively managed. It's not as if you do something and you can forget it. You always have to go back. So today we are managing about 5 million documents in the system, and with all the problems you already mentioned, OCR, wrong scans, and so on. So in the beginning, a lot of manual processing. So it was basically based on experience-based approach. It was the analysts, it was a lot of junior lawyers who came to us, and they had to learn the process, so you need expertise, but it's costly, error-prone, they make mistakes, and so on. So we decided to automatize. And of course, automatization typically is if-then-based, a rule-based approach with regular expressions, very cost-effective, but extremely difficult to maintain, because the courts have the tendency to change the format of the decision, or the court, the websites, they change every 2 weeks. In some countries, you have the impression it's every day. And so you have to reprogram the robots all the time. So automatization is nice when the source is stable, but when the source is not stable, it can be quite expensive as well. And then we just realized we cannot continue like that. That's why we decided, no, we're going to start to do machine learning. That was 2014, 2015. And we completely went to the machine learning approach, where we just say we have to have a probabilistic approach, much more cost-effective and much more self-maintaining. One of the challenges we're facing there as well is the huge difference of languages. Because we are global, many documents are in English, but many documents are in Portuguese, many documents are in Chinese, many documents are in Japanese, and so on. So a lot of off-the-shelf solutions that you can find work very well in English, but then you start to hit problems when you have working with Chinese documents and so on. So you can see here a histogram of the different languages we are treating today. So I will hand over to Vicky, who's going to give more detail his experience and learnings, and also show you then in demos. I think that's what you're most interested in, to show two demos of how we work. And basically, when Vicky joined the company a couple of years ago, I was asking him to develop a black box. And he will explain you what we mean by the black box.
It has been more than 2 years that I have. So when in 2015, so I happened to meet Everard. And then it was it was fantastic that he was showing us, he was showing me all the models that he used to build, the SVM, the logistic regression, and how effectively. I still remember around the same time there was a hackathon that Philip organized with Euroclea. You remember it, Philip? So, and for the hackathon, we had a very similar case to be solved, like to extract the names of the parties, representatives, and all these things. And the state of the art then was the winning prize was from regular expressions. A guy wrote like 500 regular expressions, and then he won the prize. And then after 1 month, I see an advertisement from Darts, and then they tackle the similar problem. Okay, I then go, and then Everard shows me the models that he built, like. He used CRFs, he used logistic regression and all these things, and it was machine learning powered and it was fantastic. So he built custom solutions for custom problems, everything was great, but he was dreaming big. He was thinking that, okay, you would have seen that we have in our database about 30 different languages, 4,000 different codes, and these codes change their format every now and then, so it's very complicated. He was dreaming that, why don't we build a black box? And in this black box, so I'm just gonna, a lawyer should be able to use it, so he dumps a decision, and then he should be, if he clicks entity extractor, if he clicks party name should come, all these things. But the black box should be able to recognize any kind of language, it should be able to recognize any kind of format and work. Okay, that was the thing that we started with. And then, so what I did was, I did, so the first module that I built was, had a logistic regression and SVM and some tree-based models. And then for some really complicated decisions, like for instance, some of the cases that Everett showed earlier, like they summarize a decision and then classify it into a particular category or something. They're all very hard, even two lawyers cannot agree upon making a decision. So, okay, then we decided, okay, then we will try neural networks. And that was the time when PIP install TensorFlow didn't even exist. So we had to build everything from source, all the GPU machines we got, and then we started building some recurrent convolutional neural networks or some, we did all these fancy things. We failed a number of times, and then finally, after 8 months, we got a beautiful neural network module, which was ready, and then another module with all the traditional machine learning algorithms with like logistic regression, SVM, everything ready. Now, what we could do is, given that thanks to our rich training data, whenever I go to the community and talk to people, they always complain about lack of training data, hence they use semi-supervised algorithms, or they try to manually label, or they use Amazon Mechanical Turk or something like that. In DARTs, the challenge has always been that we are overwhelmed with training data, hence managing the training data is a big task for us. So we started building models, and then our clients, the lawyers who work with us, the legal experts, I show them all these nice graphs and then the tables with the performance metrics and all these things. And then they're like, I explain them what an F1 score is, what accuracy is, and then they're all okay about it. And then what they do is they take some 10 random decisions, random documents, and they ask to test live. And they're very strict about AI. So even if the model makes mistake at one single part, then they are like, okay, Vicky, why did it make this mistake? Why did it make such a prediction? The problem was we built a black box, and which was not almost interpretable. So I didn't know what to do, and all these complex neural networks, it had like 7-8 layers of deep network, so we did not know what to do. And then we made one month of study, and then that was the time when these attention models started coming up. And then we built attention modules for the neural networks, and then for all the traditional machine learning algorithms, we built using the weights of the features, we built a module. So for every model that we built, then we also built simultaneously an interpretation module, which you can open the model and then see why it made such a prediction. So if my classifier says that this particular point of law is present, then when the analyst doubts it, then I can go and open, and then I can take out the sentences which triggered him to make this prediction. So we built all these modules, okay? Okay, and I think this process, maybe Everett should explain this machine learning process in general, how it happens now in DARTs.
So we're putting more and more, we're really moving the whole analysis phase to full automatization. So basically, we have a training data, and Vicky and his colleagues are deciding on a model based on the question we have. Is it an entity extraction, it's a meaning extraction, is it a damage forecasting, and so on. And he trains the machine, so basically he's learning to estimate the parameters. We get a model, and then we start to play with it, and we get unknown data, we try to do predictions, and then a very important moment, we have to decide whether the predictions are good or not good. And a very important rule in DARTs IP, a data scientist can never decide whether it's good or not good. It's never him. It's always a business person, in this case, for us, a legal analyst. So it's a legal analyst here that will decide whether the data is good or not good. So he comes with the model, he goes to the legal analyst, he says, do it again, not good, and he has to go back. Very, very important. And only when we're convinced that we have a very high percentage of a success rate, we roll out to production. Of course, again, our lucky part, we were lucky because we did not foresee that 10 years ago, is that we have trained manually all those data. So what we're really doing now is to look what can we automatize and then next, what next can we do, and just taking the data from the past to train the system.
So, okay, so we really wanted to show you a demo of two of the products that we built. One is the point of law extractor. So a point of law, I'll quickly summarize. Point of law is like when you read through a decision, the judge, the lawyer identifies certain key interesting points, and then he categorizes a document into one of the categories. So this is point of law extraction. So I will show you a demo of the point of law extraction, which is a stable tool, and we are using it every day. And then I really wanted to show you another thing. It's trademark similarity recognition. It's an image similarity recognition tool that we are building right now. It's still in the prototype phase. So, but we thought it would be fun for fun to show a demo of it. Okay, so okay, let's go here. For people,
on the screen.
Thomas, may I have your help, please? Project. Okay, I should duplicate. It's okay? So this is how a document that a decision looks like that is published by the court. Okay, so there are detailed informations and things like that. Like for instance, you see here it says trademark section 2D bars registration. So these are all like the rules, the legal rules behind which like these are the legal rules which has some meaning behind it. I really don't know what it is. Okay. So anyways, the thing is, I copy this decision, okay? I copy the text of this decision, and then, okay. Now let's see what happens. That's already a good start. I have two errors. No, they are warnings. Anyways, so you see, now my algorithm predicted that the topic of overall similarity has been discussed, and it says that the sentences which triggered him to predict this particular topic was discussed is because of the trademark section 2D was present in it. And then he says that the topic of similarity of channels of trade like is present, it's because of a very because of this sentence. So now he's able to come up with the sentences which triggered him to make a particular conclusion. So this is very interesting, and now whenever my algorithm makes a prediction, I have a reason behind it, and if the lawyer is skeptical about the prediction, they can go back and then they can check the trigger sentences so that they are confident enough to make, and especially this is very helpful to debug the models. When the model is not performing well, you can open and see which sentences are the trigger sentences, and then you can understand what the model is actually looking at. And most of the times, it's the OCR quality, which is the big hurdle for us. So, of course, we have some custom solutions to.
Just a very important question. Normally, a decision or analyst need between 10 to half an hour to analyze it. This was 5 seconds. So you can see the huge cost savings. The other side effect that we did not foresee, sometimes we reprocess on all data and we see mismatch between or the algorithm and what has been analyzed in the past. When we dive into it, very, very often, it was an analysis mistake from the past. So it also allows us for us to do quality check in the past. So that's really what has been quite impressive for internally, has impressed a lot of people, is that we can also use it for quality checks on the backlog.
Okay. So this is a prototype of our image similarity tool. Now, maybe, Everett, can you explain about TMView?
And trademarks, a big part of our business is trademark law. And the big question when you have a conflict between trademark is whether two trademarks are similar. If the trademarks are verbal, it's very easy. You see number of letters which are similar. It's not that complex. The big challenge, of course, is what we call image similarity. And the rest on the European Union is using one of the softwares to find trademark similarity. They're using what they call trademark vision, which is a neural network as well. But we found the results not good enough because you're looking for similar cases. And we have a huge database of trademarks. All lawyers want to say, is there any other case with a similar image? They cannot do that manually. That's impossible. So the result that you will get now at the European Court, can you show?
Yeah, if their website works, okay. Okay. Let's hope their website works, but let's see our results.
You see, we put as input the first, go on top. The first was the...
So that's the input?
Yes.
This particular man who is drinking the beer. The most important thing during the trademark similarity extractor is the lawyer, the legal analyst extracts the interesting or the dominant features. For instance, a saint with a beer, and then in a ribbon written saint or something like that, so the ribbon. So these three are the dominant features for him to make. So he tries to find similar images which also have these things as dominant features. Now, if you see our first match is exactly the same image, and then the second match is a man very similar to that with a beer or something like that. Okay, and then you see that the fourth one also has a man with a very similar ribbon and things like that.
This is huge, because you have to see how much time people spend to find similar trademarks. When you have millions of images, no way can... Well, in the meantime, it's still down.
It's still down, but I did something very smartly that Everard can be proud of finally. The thing is, I think I took a screenshot of their result.
Thank you, Vicky. You did well. So basically, these are the results you get online at what is considered one of the top-notch image recognition. Honestly, from a legal perspective, it's so far away. It's so far away. And we got feedback from a client saying, no, for image recognition, it's really important. Drinking a beer, for a trademark of both beers, it's extremely important. And so we decided, no, we can do better. And so Vicky worked hard on that the last couple of months. And so what you saw is the kind of results that we're getting there. Maybe you can give another example?
Yeah, I can try another one.
Yes, but they... No, the image recognition is still for us, it's a test phase. We're the first audience to see it, by the way. The UIP was a very, very big user for us to find their own decisions and national decisions, but that's for the rest of the system. Image recognition, they haven't seen it yet. But I will be delighted to show them.
No, should you, okay. I'm trying their website. Hope, no. Okay.
Well, you can try, it's online, you can always... Okay, this is also an interesting one. You see this is a skull with a hat. Of course, the first one very close is the same, and then very close. And what's important, he got the meaning, the concept of a hat on a skull. So we have a lot of skulls in the database, but he is able to identify that the ones, for example, the second one on the second row is a military helmet and so on. He got the concept of a hat and a skull. If you can go down, you can see other ones. But also, the type of hat plays a role, because you see RM on the left, it's a hat. Very, very similar. But this for trademark lawyers is extremely relevant because they find similar cases with very close images and from the concept perspective. It's a hat and a skull. And you can take a third one.
Yeah. I thought we will have competitive advantage over them only with the machine learning algorithm. But even if we design the website well, then...
The next one is also an interesting one because it's a tower with text. And there are two aspects. The tower is stylized with, you will see, with red dots. And so we want the system to find back towers, but also the same style. And so the way we have built the algorithm is that he gets both. Both are important for us, if you are lucky.
Philip, can you please have a fast internet next time?
No, okay, yeah. Here, look. Of course, this is the input, and then you see the second one, the style is very important. The third one is a tower. The fourth one is also a stylized tower. So exactly, this is relevant.
Actually, this is, like, if you look closely at the image, if you look closely at the image, you see the image is composed of blocks, blocks. You see, are you able to see?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, so. So you see, in the second result, there are blocks of tower. So I find...
Second, this, the left one is very important as well. It's this concept of red dots, very close, with text. So this is typically this kind of thing that we're doing now. And so we're going to implement that in a database, so where today people can search on topics, they're going to be able to upload the image, and we'll give them all the cases in the world with similar images. So you upload an apple, and you will get the 650 cases of apples in the world. An apple with a bite, you will get only apples with a bite. So this is coming for May. So...
okay, so the...
Last thing.
Yeah.
No, we never have 100% of the decision. Nobody has it, and who claims is just lying. There are some countries, like the US, you can get close to 100% because the US is disclosing a lot online, what they call PACER. Countries, like for example, very important countries, but very difficult to get, for example, Germany. We go manually every day to the court, and we have people going to the door of the judges, noting down what's the case today he's handling, and 3 months later we order the decision. By law, they're obliged to give it to us when you have the docket number. So every country has his problem, but we will never say we have 100%. It doesn't exist. But what we know, we're the most complete. That's already a starting point. Before I conclude, this is, I mean, everybody knows that, but for us it's quite interesting. The four ingredients for the AI growth. Technology, we were a small company when we started. We could not afford to have huge servers. With the cloud, it's fantastic. You need a lot of computing power. You just use the cloud, and you can really have good results. The data, we were extremely lucky. We have a lot of training data by chance, let's be honest. The algorithms are well known. There are papers. Vicky is reading a lot of paper with Wojciech. They learn it, they can find it, and they improve it. The last one is a difficult one. Data scientists, it's really a problem to find the good data scientists. It's a high demand, and so for us, it's a challenge to find the good ones. And we don't see that solving. You see here the graph, that's the number of data scientist positions the last couple of years. It's just exploding. But let's see where you're going to stand in 10 years. I don't know. So that was basically it. Open for questions, of course, if any. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for this presentation. I just would like to ask a question. Do you imagine to develop metrics in order to, the basis of the case law, have some kind of indication whether two different
images... We have this already.
Okay, you have that already?
Yeah, that's what...
Do you imagine, because it gives like an argument for lawyers to say, okay, in that case, we have 96% of resemblance and the court decide that it's not the same.
No, that we have. When you can have two cases, you enter the parameters and then you're going to say likelihood of confusion is so high, likelihood on every topic. And you can see also the likelihood to appeal and so on.
Yeah, you can just go to our website, Darts IP, and you can see for all our features. You can ask for a trial.
We still have time for a question.
Sorry.
Feedback from the customer, yes? If they have a result from the screen.
Yes. There's a online feedback that they can use in theory. Don't use it that much. Sometimes we have. Typically, it's an error of it's a wrong classification. It can happen. Of course, we take it with us. That's possible, but honestly, I think we have quite a good track record on there. We did a lot of checking and surveys and so on, and feedback is quite positive. Honestly, there are more errors done by human beings than by the system. That's what we have seen the last couple of years.
But still, we have a team of operation data scientists who focus on, so we are from the lab, so we develop the algorithms, and these operation data scientists go and try to monitor the performance of the algorithm. They make spot checks, of the analysis that our legal experts do, so there is a consistent quality measure that we keep on estimating, and then we have these quality dashboards that get refreshed every single day to monitor all these spot check quality, yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. We can have a drink, and so you can ask all the questions you want. And thanks again for coming. Sir. This is really impressive. So
thanks.
Yeah, congratulations.
Okay.
So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here tonight. We were talking about the availability of data scientists. Vicky here is one of the examples of people who were involved in the different trainings we did at when we were still at AXA. And I'm sure he learned a lot by participating in different hackathons. He also was one of the winners of the music hack we organized last summer. The next meetups we are organizing, there is one in French on the 20th of February, and it will be about l'éthique dans l'intelligence artificielle, which could be interesting. Very shortly after that, because this French one is already overbooked with more than 200 people who have registered, we will repeat it with other speakers in English, and it will take place here. We're also organizing the Data Innovation Summit like we do every year. That's an event that happens at ULB. Last year we had about 800 people. This year we expect about 1,000 people to be present. The theme of this year is about being human in a world of AI. There will be a strong impact on ethics during that event, and a strong impact on governance. How can we make sure that it's the person that stays in control and not the machine that takes over? So to organize this event, we will also have different preparation meetups. One preparation meetup will be about helping us to select the AI startup of the year. So there is a call that is being sent out. And then there will also be another evening where we will have AI projects, the most interesting AI projects of the year, where you will all be invited. I would like to thank the tech team with Ricardo, who made sure that everything that you've seen today is available on our Facebook page and on Instagram. All the presentation have been recorded and are there for you to watch again. And I really hope that you will leave here with a very good feeling that you have done a lot of network. The evening is not finished. The bar is open. And I hope to see you back soon. Thank you very much. Thank you for all the speakers.
That frog.